Bonjour. We're at the Stephen Holt Show with Edith Piaf booming in the background at the Veau door with Cathy Treboux, the Etoile Réservée. So we're doing today the best films of the decade, Cathy, with our super critics, Francis Chervenak and Merrick Bursuk will be here.
Good to have you all again.
Thank you. And looking back on the decade, it's, the uh-ohs, I call them. Do you have any high points or anything? Or
No.
What did they
no.
look like to you? That just one meal after, one fabulous meal after the other. At Le Vaudor. Where's the address again?
Well, the 21st century. We haven't entered the 20th century, so we surely haven't entered the 21st century.
Yes. I know, and I have to say, this is where Ernest Hemingway was sat over there, and you were telling me Grace Kelly met Oleg Cassini here, and he fell in love with her.
That's right, yes.
Where did that happen?
Right.
Over there?
Yeah, over here, too. Table hopping from
and
one to the other.
Orson Welles was always over here because he needed this space.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
So, anyway, we're going to be doing our 10 best films of the decade today. It's just with Edith being, you know, well, she's haunting me because one of the high points of my decade was interviewing Marion Cotillard and helping her get her Oscar for La Vie en Rose, but that is not one of my best films, so it certainly was one of the best performances of the decade, but we're going to be talking about the best films since 2000. It's a new century. It's the 21st. So, what is it?
Allez-y.
The French correct. The Français correct. And now I have the great honor and privilege of introducing our two super film critics, Francis Chervenak and Merrick Bursuk.
Hi.
Are both back again to take a look at the decade of the OOs or the uh-ohs, or anyway, our 10 best films that we like the best, each of us. And they're going to be very different, I'm just guessing, but or maybe they won't.
Yep.
Okay. So, what was your number 10, Francis Chervenak?
My number 10 was The Aviator.
Martin Scorsese's.
And star. My number 10 is The Hurt Locker.
Okay, that's the film that's out this year on the Iraq War. And my number 10 was 101 Reykjavik from 2000, which was... did you ever hear of that film?
No.
It was my best film of that year because that was the sort of summed up when I was in Iceland.
I see.
And it was Balthasar Kormákr's sort of breakout film at the Toronto Film Festival, and it went all over the world and established him for the first time as a kind of, you know, an international. And it was a comedy starring Victoria Abril, mm-hmm. and she's having an affair with the leading character, whose name is Líners, by a wonderful performance by Hilmar Snæfgenusson. We've had them all on the show when we were in Iceland. Oh, my God, Iceland. Oh. Yes, we all went to Iceland. And... anyway, it was a comedy about, of all things, a lesbian wedding, which at that time, it was legal in Iceland to have gay marriage.
It
and this
still
was
is.
Just this, mm-hmm. and it still is, and it was just this whole totally new thing to me. Mm-hmm. This just, I mean, it wasn't, I couldn't believe it was happening.
Yes,
it was
lesbian
like a
marriage would be new.
And Merrick, you didn't say anything about The Hurt Locker on the last show. Which,
yes, I did, but.
But, I mean, you just mentioned it.
No, I spoke about Hurt Locker when we were picking our top 10 of the year, actually.
Yes.
And then also before the show before that. Anyway, yes, The Hurt Locker, which everybody probably knows by now, and I hope I haven't given it the kiss of death, because as I look at my top 10, I've noticed none of my top 10 have ever won an Academy Award. This film, I think, is my pick for the Academy Award this year.
But it has your Academy Award. That's
yes,
what's important.
That
Merrick.
Is important.
The Oscars don't
tell
matter.
Tell it to Catherine.
You're what matters.
Tell it to Catherine. Mm-hmm.
Tell it to who?
Catherine. Yes.
Catherine
Bigelow.
Bigelow. Catherine Zeta-Jones is on Broadway. Looking forward to having her on the show in Little Night Music. But anyway, The Aviator. Say something about The Aviator.
Pretty much I love The Aviator because Martin Scorsese really captured how the young Howard Hughes pretty much suffered from his own demons with obsessive compulsive disorder and paranoia, and how although he was able to do all these great things like, you know, run a movie studio, set aviation records, he was also a man who couldn't open a door because he was afraid of germs. And I thought just how he was able to balance such a complex figure who could be very intelligent yet at the same time very superstitious and very paranoid.
Okay, Francis, what's your Number nine.
My number nine is another movie from 2004, Collateral.
Okay, I don't know what that was. Merrick.
My number nine is The Great World of Sound, which I'm sure nobody knows either.
I might. Yeah. And my number nine is The White Ribbon, which you all know and don't like. And my number eight was Talk to Her, or Hablo con Ella, by Pedro Almodovar, which was about, did you ever see that film, Francis?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, about, you know, the female bullfighter who gets, you know, and you think the film is going to be all about this woman, and she's the female matador in this whole thing, and then she gets gored by the bull and becomes like a comatose coma victim. That's redundant, but hey, it's the Stephen Holt show. And but then the film shifts to be about the male nurse who's taking care of the coma victims and the relationships that he has with them in their sleep, as it were. And what was your number?
My number eight was The Dark Knight.
Okay, we all know what that was about. I know, and you're number eight.
Well, also, mine doesn't need very much introduction either. It's The Reader, which was from last year
I
really loved. I don't think we need
well,
to
I think
go
you,
into
no,
it.
Well, I think you can both talk about both
well,
of these.
Go ahead.
No,
you talk about The Dark Knight.
I mean, pretty much...
Yeah, I remember you just loved it. You just loved it.
I mean,
it.
Pretty much The Dark Knight just took the comic book movie and just, in my opinion, added such a level of moral quality and depth to it that... Ultimately, I was just really impressed, really taken away, and it just had that electricity about it where you just wanted to see it again and again.
And you did.
And ultimately, it's just hands down.
How many
really
times did you see
it? More than I can count.
Oh, okay. All right. I remember there was one point they were showing the bat signal on the on the side of a building, and I remember you.
That was pretty cool.
Did you go down to see that, or you did? You did. That's when he was working at the New York Times, ladies and gentlemen. And Mr. Bursuk, I love that movie,
The Reader,
too.
Yeah, well, talk
it.
About moral dilemmas. Quality that you were speaking of in The Batman, The Dark Knight. This truly is a great film. It's the story is amazing. The acting is amazing. A lot of twists and turns. It looked at a time that has been used in films an awful lot as a subject matter, obviously, at times of Nazi Germany, and also brought it up into... It had time displacement. It also brought it up 10-20 years later. Just a remarkable film, great script, great acting.
And a great performance by
Kate Winslet,
who won the Oscar, with my help. Anyway, my number seven is Memento. And what's your number seven?
My number seven is Avatar.
Okay,
and my number seven is Apocalypto.
Apocalypto.
You'll know that also because I brought it up.
The Mel Gibson movie set in the Amazon.
That's right.
In Mayan. Okay. Yes. All right. Okay. Well, I have a feeling Memento might come up in the discussion later, and I'll let you talk about it then, and we'll go right to your other... Cool. What was your number?
My number seven was Avatar.
Avatar, you can talk about that, since you were right on the ball about that film.
Pretty much Avatar was just like... perfect film to cap off the decade. I mean, from its use of the 3D camera, its visuals. While it may not have had the best story, I felt it really encouraged people to look at a movie in a different way.
Because of the 3D?
Because of the 3D, because of the visuals, because of the style. Like, ultimately encouraged people to look at something more because people are already drawn to, like, the epic scope.
Everybody's seeing it. They're going back to see it again and again. How many times have you seen this one?
Not as many times as The Dark Knight, but still a good number.
A good number. I know our cameraman, Andrew. Mm-hmm. A shout out to Andrew Lyman-Clarke, our wonderful cameraman. How many times have you seen it?
Twice.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And Merrick, your film...
I thought you were going to ask me how many times I've seen it.
My film
is Apocalypto. I think you know the answer to that. My film, as I mentioned, was Apocalypto, which you briefly mentioned. Basically, it takes place in the Mayan kingdom back in when the Mayan civilization was just going through its crumbling period, and it's a subtitled film. It's in Mayan.
It's in Mayan or
you
so.
Know, he did a film.
Mayan.
Yeah, he did a film in Mayan. He did a film in Aramaic. He does very strange subtitled films, but. I'm not a big fan of Mel Gibson. Yeah, I'm not a big fan of Mel Gibson, but this film I felt was an amazing film. It was a haunting film. It kept me mesmerized for the entire time I watched it, and I've actually seen that film more than once.